switch that scene, so the in-game there, and the chat should be updating in the background. I'll just click on it to make sure that it is actually updating properly. All right, there we go. Good stuff, and welcome back, guys. Welcome back to this series between the Viper and Vic Winchester. I don't know if it's the best of five or what, but it certainly has been good so far. And these guys breaking the mold of the AOC meta, actually playing some non-mirror civ matchups. And this time we've got Vic Winchester to the north, the east of the map in the purple, playing as the Persians. And down to the south of the map, in the yellow once again, we do have the Viper playing as the Huns. And this is probably going to be, I want to say this already, a little bit of a tough one for Winchester. He did play excellently well in that last game. Managing to take a game from the Viper is no small thing. And I think he should be incredibly, incredibly pleased with that victory in that last game. And I think if any player is able to beat the Viper, that's like a benchmark of success. Once you get to the stage where you're able to beat him once, then you know that you are onto a good thing and that you are doing something right. So hopefully Winchester can take something from that last game. I know the civs were, you know, in one sense, certainly in his favor. But this time, I think it's going to be a little bit more difficult. Persians versus the Huns. And we know the Huns are a fantastically strong civ on Arabia. We know that they are incredibly fast. And we know that those are the conditions that the Viper likes to play under. Fast and furious. He's just too fast, too furious. And he is, well, going to be representing the Huns today down here in the south. Now, I've got to say, one thing I like about Winchester is he's consistently choosing the color purple. He's choosing the color 6, which is good. That is the right color to be choosing, and certainly better than the color 4 that the Viper is choosing here, the yellow. I've noticed the Viper playing in yellow quite a lot, actually. I don't know if that's just because he prefers that color. Yellow, after all, is the color of the gold on the map, and the Viper has certainly won a lot of gold playing AOC, if you convert all of those dollars into gold. Anyway, I'm sure he's won many, many amounts of gold, many grams of gold, through playing AOC and his AOC career. So perhaps that is the connection between the Viper and the color yellow. I don't know. I'm just going off on a random tangent. But let's have a quick look at the Viper's map. It looks pretty abysmal, let's be honest. He has fortunately got a very easy wall on this left-hand side, which is certainly a very positive thing for him. But that's about the only positive thing to take from this map. His wood is miles out from his town center, right the way on the front. His right-hand side is incredibly open. There's no tree line over here because they're playing the stupid standard Arabia and not the dry Arabia. And his gold is at the bottom of a hill. His front of the map is completely open. And as the Huns, not having houses, means there are no easy options to wall this aside from palisades galore. So his map is pretty abysmal, and for that reason, he's probably going to want to play this one very aggressively. The best defense is sometimes aggression, and I think the Viper might just go for that option here simply because of how open and how bad his map is looking. Winchester, on the other hand, well, his map is looking a little bit nicer. He's got a semi-back gold here. He can probably keep that nice and secure thanks to these tree line and these tree lines and this cliff face on the left side. He's also got a reasonably easy wall on the right as well, simply between this cliff here and this lake, a very easy wall for him to make there. And of course, the front of his base could be walled up with houses and stables and the like. So Persians for Winchester probably want to switch, going to go into the castle age with knights. Has got the option, of course, to go with some camels if the Viper is making knights as well, which is the beauty of the Persians. They do have that option to switch between the knights and the camels there. But I have a feeling that the Viper may want to rush this one, and he has got 4 villagers on the wood, and we can probably expect to see a drush. Like I say, the barracks there going up, it's like I can read his mind. Well, only not quite, because if I could read his mind, I would probably be 2k plus, but I'm not, so there you go. But he is indeed doing a barracks, and it makes so much sense in his position. Now, at the moment, he doesn't have loom, but he is going to send a villager over to the gold now to collect 10 gold, and he will do loom at the end of the feudal age. It would be pretty suicidal if he didn't. The question is, will he send some forward villagers as well? Because if he does send some forward villagers here, then he could really put on a little bit of extra pressure onto Winchester as well. And that could be really beneficial to him. Now, Winchester's scouting at the moment. He's found that wood there. And obviously, if he sees this lumber camp, that's pretty, self-explanatory. It means that Viper has no other closer wood, otherwise he would have taken it. So, very open. And the problem for this game, for Winchester here, sorry, for the Viper here, is that if he plays aggressively and keeps Winchester busy inside of his base, Winchester's got the disadvantage with the fact that, Viper could have the disadvantage if Winchester decides to counterattack. If Winchester just defends nicely, sends out a counterattack with a few scouts, Viper could end up losing quite a few villagers as they attempt to run back towards his TC. So Winchester's going up on 21 population. That's a really early upgrade time, actually. He's still got his scout, and he's going up on 20 villagers, which is not very many villagers at all. He's taken some gold at the back. He's palisaded these guys in so that they can take gold in peace and safety. And he is going forwards with these 5 villagers now and building some militia of his own. Interesting decision. Obviously, he is keeping tabs on this militia rush from the Viper now. And using his scout there to get some pot shots in as well. That wolf getting involved for good measure. And the more that Winchester keeps these militia busy, the more damage that wolf was able to do. And I think that wolf managing to take that militia down over half HP. Winchester coming forwards with those villagers, bringing the militia in as well. And Winchester here looks like he's going to play a really nice strategy, actually. He's going to go for man-at-arms once he reaches the castle age. And I imagine that will be very, very strong for him. Taking one of those militia down already, there's the man-at-arms upgrade, and Winchester's looking like he is going to play this one really well. Viper's wood is so exposed, and Viper is not going to be able to defend these lumber camps with a single spearman like he would be able to do if Winchester were to scout rush. Now, obviously, he's still got these 5 villagers forwards. We could probably see a forwards not a forward archery range. That is a forward archery range, so we can expect to see that, I guess. But we could probably expect to see a forward tower as well, which would once again make the gold for the Viper, the wood for the Viper inaccessible here. Would be incredible if he could pull it off. Like, if he could get a tower there, that would deny this wood line, and it would deny this one as well. But no, he's going to put his tower on the front. It's still a good location. It's going to hit these villagers on this wood line. It's going to deny this stone, and it's going to be firing downhill. Viper trying to take some deer at the front of the map, but he's going to have a pretty difficult time doing that. And if he's not careful, he will lose his scout as well. And Viper now pulling everything he's got to prevent this tower going up. Both of them fighting with villagers, and Winchester bringing in an archer here for good measure as well. Viper's scout so close to going down, and all the villagers are fighting right now, but Winchester will have the upper hand. He does have those man-at-arms, they are man-at-arms now. Man-at-arms in there, but he's bottling out. He's going back, and he's building that second archery range at the moment. So Winchester, not able to keep that pressure on, forced to delete that tower, and that has cost him 34 gold in total, which is quite a bit of gold to lose. He can still afford to build another tower, so it's not the end of the world. But Winchester now with these 5 forward villagers, they're all a little bit hurt. They're all starting to bleed out a little bit, and Winchester now once again trying for the tower. Now, Winchester, with these 5 idle villagers, they are losing the potential to gather quite a lot of resources. But if he gets this tower up, it's going to be quite a big deal. Winchester tried to fight these skirmishers with his man-at-arms. And I've got to say, I really am enjoying this play from Winchester. The man-at-arms in the feudal age have become more and more popular these days. We're seeing players intentionally go for this build. We're seeing players purposefully building into man-at-arms, completely off their own steam, not just because they have some militia left over and it's worth upgrading them. They're actually making this build order from scratch, and it actually works really nicely. Viper, though, going for these skirms at the moment. He has got access to gold on this right-hand side, but he's not going for it yet. He's just going to use these skirms and micro them so that he can keep these man-at-arms at bay. Michael Bay. Anyway, Viper here, getting that tower up on the left side, so he is going to deny the tower from Winchester, and that's very costly, actually. Winchester's going to get no value out of the 159 stone that he just spent. He's going to get nothing from it, and as a result, he's now going to have to mine some stone as well if he wants to get that second and third TC once he reaches the castle age, if he reaches the castle age. Viper, though, seemingly getting stuck with these skirms. The skirmishers here, very low on health, and these men-at-arms just able to tank this all day long, coming in with their short swords, slapping these skirmishers around the face with a little bit of steel, and they are taking a bit of a beating, actually, losing quite a few skirms here, and not a single man-at-arms has died yet. The first two just going down as they get in range of that tower there. Pretty bad to get in range of a tower like that. That will pierce through your armor very quickly. And 1 HP left on this man-at-arms here. Just one more shot. Will he get the skirmisher first, though? Of course he won't. Viper bringing those skirms into position. But Viper very much locked inside of his base at the moment. Not a whole lot he can do. And we've got the inclusion now of archers from Winchester as well, as he's got 5 villagers taking gold back here. So he can support archer production from one range, but he does actually have a little bit more gold in the bank. So he can actually keep those archers coming out for now. Now, neither of them have that fletching upgrade just yet. It's quite slow to come out, but it's actually understandable. Viper only just getting onto gold right now, and his food is pretty low as well since he's been making these skirms. But that fletching upgrade on the skirmish is not going to be so crucial anyway. The fletching upgrade on the skirms doesn't really do a whole lot. It's mostly for the range, I feel. The extra attack damage you get, not going to be all that useful to the Viper here, but nicely done. Getting Winchester caught between his TC and this wall, and Winchester going to get back, sorry, Viper going to get back into his TC there and kill off a couple of units here as they run through, and Viper getting a few kills there for absolutely free, which is really good for him, and bringing himself back into that game, or back into this game even, with the score lead now. Very nicely done. I feel like Winchester really trying to pressure the Viper way too heavily and not getting enough from it. So far, he's lost a lot of units and not really done too much damage. I think Viper may be losing just one or two villagers, if that. We can have a quick look at the military tab, though. We can see that Viper's killed 17 and lost 11, whereas Winchester has killed 11 and lost 17. And he has lost a few gold units here as well, which are arguably a lot more valuable than these skirmishers from the Viper here. Winchester, what's he doing? Trying to put up a tower there, unaware that the Viper is on his tail with these skirms. Viper splitting his skirms up, and of course this guy's going to take a long time to take those villagers down, but they will whittle away at them eventually. They are going to be able to take those villagers out, and Winchester losing a couple of villagers here, not ideal. And once again, those 5 villagers that he sent forward have been had a lot of idle time from them. And ultimately, I don't think that they have been very well used by Winchester this game. So this is looking pretty good for the Viper at the moment, considering his situation with this map. His skirmishers are putting out the damage at the moment. They are completely stopping Winchester's archers in their tracks. And meanwhile now, Viper's on the gold again. He can start archer production himself. And that is, of course, the preferable unit in this situation. The archers are better once they reach the castle age. They're going to have that extra range as well once they get Bodkin Arrow. And of course, fletching a Bodkin Arrow. And they're also going to have extra attack damage when raiding villagers, which is always worth keeping in mind, even when you're on the defensive. So interestingly enough, Viper's taking some stone now as well. And he's actually putting up a defensive tower on this gold. Makes sense that he's trying to protect his flank here. He's still so just resistant to making any walls. He's just not willing to wall up, but he will put some towers up in defense just to be on the safe side. I think that's a good call. It's going to mean that he can keep this gold safe for now and actually continue that archer production quite safely as well. Winchester, meanwhile, actually really far from the castle age still. And I mean, he did spend quite a lot of resources making those men-at-arms there. Of course, the men-at-arms upgrade itself costing 100 food, the men-at-arms each costing 60 food as well. So that did drain his food eco quite a lot, and that's completely understandable why he is so far at the moment very low on the food count. But switching into archers now should allow him to reach the castle age in a reasonable time still. Question is, will Viper push out with a counterattack and start killing off Winchester's villagers? Indeed, he will. And going in there, denying those villagers the stone that they so dearly want to gather from this stone mine. But yeah, locked inside the tower, what are they going to do? These guys unable to shoot into the tower where these cowardly villagers are hiding, but they are able to sit at the bottom of it and keep them idle, which is costing Winchester some very important and crucial villager gathering time. These archers from Winchester seem to be littered all over the place. Viper now massing his army a little bit more. These skirmishers finally with fletching done, giving them the ranged advantage as well. That's going to be a little bit of a problem for Winchester to deal with. So Winchester starting to make a lot of watchtowers, and that's usually a bad sign. If you've got more than two or three watchtowers up in your base, it's not good, because it means you've spent a lot of stone building them. Stone which later on you're going to have to want to use for castles, which are much more valuable, and for TCs, which are so important in the early castle age. And these towers here, kind of just almost a waste. It's like, well, if you could just wall this, you would save so much stone, but it's not an easy wall to make. Winchester would have to spend quite a lot of time and resources on making the palisades, but at least he would save the stone. Viper adding in some more towers as well, and this map is just so open for both of them that they both feel the need to make a lot of towers this game, and at the very least it's going to keep their villagers safe, so that's handy dandy. Winchester here getting caught out a little bit with his archers though, getting whittled away by those towers, and just when you think you're out of range, you know they will fire one more volley and you will lose yet another archer. They always catch me off guard, just how much range they have. 9 range, it's insane. So much range. But anyway, Viper now is on the way up to the castle age. His food economy looking pretty good. He doesn't have that many farms, but since he switched into archers, he is going to have that food piling up a little bit more now, now that he's not making skirmishes anymore. So Viper's up, and he's going to have those crossbows done as soon as he gets up to the castle age, and he's probably just going to follow through with the cavalry archer production. That third range coming up, and I wouldn't even be surprised if we see a fourth range as well. And once Viper gets those cavalry archers out, he will gain a lot of map control, which he's actually starting to regain at the moment as well. Winchester looking for the castle age upgrade, just doing wheelbarrow at 26 minutes. That's really late, and that probably explains why Viper's able to go up sooner, even with less farms. I assume he has the wheelbarrow upgrade. Let's just check it. Checking it. Yep, that wheelbarrow upgrade is done. Viper able to make much more use of these villagers, or make these villagers much more efficient on their farms. Also looking pretty good in the military numbers. 29 military units, 30 military units for the Viper now, and 0 military for Winchester. So we're going to see 30 crossbows, about 15 crossbows even, heading towards the Viper's base now. Winchester's base now, my god. And Winchester going to be defending with these towers, but that's it. He has resigned. He is calling it a day. That is no... Winchester is no more. Winchester just unable to reach the castle age here. He was one food off when he resigned there, but I think he realized that, you know, a simple palisade wall on this right-hand side is not enough. He's invested so much into building towers here, and whilst, yes, they would keep a few of his villagers safe, ultimately, they're still no use to him if they're gathered inside of towers for the rest of the game. So Castor asking in the chat, what's the best time to get wheelbarrow? It depends on if you're fast castling or if you're doing a feudal war. If you're doing a feudal war and it's prolonged, you should do it at 15 minutes. If you're fast castling, you should do it, once you've reached the castle age, ideally. If you're doing knights, you want to do the wheelbarrow a little bit earlier so that you can keep the villager production and the night production going. The thing with Wheelbarrow is that it makes your farmers much more efficient. Obviously, it gives all of your villagers extra carrying capacity, but with things like lumber, gold, and stone, your villagers don't have to walk very far to the drop-off point. So this villager here is going to be about the same efficiency, whether or not it has Wheelbarrow or not. But with the villagers, because they have to walk such a long way between the drop-off point and the farming area, the Wheelbarrow upgrade makes them much more efficient, and it means that you get a lot more food over time because they're not spending so long walking. So there you go. Let's go back, look at these achievements then. Military stats, the Viper, 34 killed, 11 lost. Very nicely done. Much larger army at the end of the game there as well. I think Winchester realizing, hey, I've got no army here. Viper's just hit castle and he's going to have crossbows in my base. Viper managing to get more on all counts of resources as well. That food, very different. 1,100 food difference there. But you've got to be fair to Winchester. He was playing the Persians. A pretty difficult civilization to play against the Huns, especially when the Huns are being fielded by the Viper. Such a speedy player. And there's the timeline, if anyone cares. I say this every time. Just timeline, yeah. It's just a bit of colour. Means nothing. Now, you can get a little bit from this. If we analyse the timeline here, Viper with the later feudal upgrade time. But really, you want to look at the gradient, the shading here. The light...